Macmillan Audio presents The Name of the Rose by Umberto Eco, translated from the Italian by William Weaver, read for you by Sean Barrett with Nicholas Rowe and Neville Jason.
Preface. On August 16th, 1968, I was handed a book written by a certain Abbé Vallée, Le manuscrit de Dom Adson de Melk, traduit en français d'après l'édition de Dom J. Mabillon, aux presses de l'Abbé de la Source, Paris, 1842. Supplemented by historical information that was actually quite scant, the book claimed to reproduce faithfully a 14th century manuscript that, in its turn, had been found in the monastery of Melk by the great 18th century man of learning, to whom we owe so much information about the history of the Benedictine order. The scholarly discovery, I mean mine, the third in chronological order, entertained me while I was in Prague waiting for a dear friend. 6 days later, Soviet troops invaded that unhappy city. I managed, not without adventure, to reach the Austrian border at Linz. And from there I journeyed to Vienna, where I met my beloved, and together we sailed up the Danube. In a state of intellectual excitement, I read with fascination the terrible story of Adso of Melk. And I allowed myself to be so absorbed by it that, almost in a single burst of energy, I completed a translation using some of those large notebooks from the Papeterie Joseph Gibert, in which it is so pleasant to write if you use a felt-tip pen. And as I was writing, we reached the vicinity of Melk, where, perched over a bend in the river, the handsome stift stands to this day, after several restorations during the course of the centuries. As the reader must have guessed, in the monastery library I found no trace of Adso's manuscript. Before we reached Salzburg, one tragic night in a little hotel on the shores of the Monse, my travelling companionship was abruptly interrupted, and the person with whom I was travelling disappeared, taking Abbé Vallée's book, not out of spite, but because of the abrupt and untidy way in which our relationship ended. And so I was left with a number of manuscript notebooks in my hand and a great emptiness in my heart. A few months later, in Paris, I decided to get to the bottom of my research. Among the few pieces of information I had derived from the French book, I still had the reference to its source, exceptionally detailed and precise. Vetera analecta, sive collectio veterum aliquot opera, et opusculorum homs generis, carminum epistolarum, diplomatum, epitaphiorum, et cum itinere germanico, adaptationibus et aliquot disquisitionibus R.P.D. Ioannis Mabillon, presbyteri ac monachi ord sancti benedicti e congregatione sancti Mauri, nova editio cui accessere Mabillonii vita et aliquot opuscula, silicet disertatio de pane eucharistico, asimo et fermentato ad eminentis, cardinalem bona, subiungitor opusculum Eldefonsi Hispaniensis episcopi de eodem argumento et Eusebi Romani ad Theophilum Gallum epistola, de cultu sanctorum ignotorum Parisiis apud Levec ad pontem Sancti Michaelis 1721 cum privilegio regis. I quickly found the Vetera Analecta at the Bibliothèque Sainte Geneviève, but to my great surprise the edition I came upon differed from the description in two details. First, the publisher, who was given here as Montalon ad ripam pp Augustinianorum prope pontem Sancti Michaelis, and also the date, which was 2 years later. I needn't add that these Analecta did not comprehend any manuscript of Adso or Adson of Melk. On the contrary, as anyone interested can check, they are a collection of brief or medium-length texts, whereas the story transcribed by Valle ran to several hundred pages. At the same time, I consulted illustrious medievalists, such as the dear and unforgettable Étienne Gilson, but it was evident that the only vetera analecta were those I had seen at Sainte Genevieve. A quick trip to the Abbey de la Source in the vicinity of Passy, and a conversation with my friend Dom Arne Lannestedt further convinced me that no Abbé Valle had published books on the Abbey's presses, for that matter, non-existent. French scholars are notoriously careless about furnishing reliable bibliographical information, but this case went beyond all reasonable pessimism. I began to think I had encountered a forgery. By now, the Valle volume itself could not be recovered, or at least I didn't dare go and ask it back from the person who had taken it from me. I had only my notes left, and I was beginning to have doubts about them. There are magic moments, involving great physical fatigue and intense motor excitement, that produce visions of people known in the past. En me retraçant ces détails, j'en suis à me demander s'ils sont réels, ou bien si je les ai rêvés. As I learned later from the delightful little book of the Abbé de Boucoy, there are also visions of books as yet unwritten. If something new had not occurred, I would still be wondering where the story of Adso of Melk originated. But then, in 1970, in Buenos Aires, as I was browsing among the shelves of a little antiquarian bookseller on Corrientes, not far from the more illustrious Patio del Tango of that great street, I came upon the Castilian version of a little work by Milo Temesvar on the use of mirrors in the game of chess. It was an Italian translation of the original, which, now impossible to find, was in Georgian, Tbilisi, 1934. And here, to my great surprise, I read copious quotations from Adso's manuscript, though the source was neither Valle nor Mabillon. It was Father Athanasius Kircher. But which work? A scholar, whom I prefer not to name, later assured me that, and he quoted indexes from memory, the great Jesuit never mentioned Adso of Melk. But Temesvar's pages were before my eyes, and the episodes he cited were the same as those of the Valle manuscript. The description of the labyrinth in particular left no room for doubt. I concluded that Adso's memoirs appropriately share the nature of the events he narrates, shrouded in many shadowy mysteries, beginning with the identity of the author and ending with the abbey's location, about which Adso is stubbornly, scrupulously silent. Conjecture allows us to designate a vague area between Pomposa and Conques, with reasonable likelihood that the community was somewhere along the central ridge of the Apennines, between Piedmont, Liguria, and France. As for the period in which the events described take place, we are at the end of November 1327. The date of the author's writing, on the other hand, is uncertain. Inasmuch as he describes himself as a novice in 1327 and says he is close to death as he writes his memoirs, we can calculate roughly that the manuscript was written in the last or next to last decade of the 14th century. On sober reflection, I find few reasons for publishing my Italian version of an obscure neo-Gothic French version of a 17th century Latin edition of a work written in Latin by a German monk toward the end of the 14th century. First of all, what style should I employ? The temptation to follow Italian models of the period had to be rejected as totally unjustified. Not only does Adso write in Latin, but it is also clear from the whole development of the text that his culture, or the culture of the abbey which clearly influences him, dates back even further. It is manifestly a summation, over several centuries, of learning and stylistic quirks that can be linked with the late medieval Latin tradition. Adso thinks and writes like a monk who has remained impervious to the revolution of the vernacular, still bound to the pages housed in the library he tells about, educated on patristic scholastic texts. And his story, apart from the 14th century references and events, which Adso reports with countless perplexities and always by hearsay, could have been written, as far as the language and the learned quotations go, in the 12th or 13th century. On the other hand, there is no doubt that in translating Adso's Latin into his own neo-Gothic French, Vallée took some liberties, and not only stylistic liberties. For example, the characters speak sometimes of the properties of herbs, clearly referring to the Book of Secrets attributed to Albertus Magnus, which underwent countless revisions over the centuries. It is certain that Adso knew the work, but the fact remains that passages he quotes from it echo too literally both formulas of Paracelsus and obvious interpolations from an edition of Albertus unquestionably dating from the Tudor period. However, I discovered later that during the time when Vallée was transcribing the manuscript of Adso, there was circulating in Paris an 18th century edition of the Grand and the Petit Albert, now irreparably corrupt. In any case, how could I be sure that the text known to Adso or the monks, whose discussions he recorded, did not also contain, among glosses, scholia, and various appendices, annotations that would go on to enrich subsequent scholarship? Finally, was I to retain in Latin the passages that Abbé Vallée himself did not feel it opportune to translate, perhaps to preserve the ambience of the period? There were no particular reasons to do so, except a perhaps misplaced sense of fidelity to my source. I have eliminated excesses, but I have retained a certain amount. And I fear that I have imitated those bad novelists who, introducing a French character, make him exclaim, "Parbleu!" and "La femme, ah, la femme!" In short, I am full of doubts. I really don't know why I have decided to pluck up my courage and present, as if it were authentic, the manuscript of Adso of Melk. Let us say it is an act of love, or if you like, a way of ridding myself of numerous persistent obsessions. I transcribe my text with no concern for timeliness. In the years when I discovered the Abbé Vallée volume, there was a widespread conviction that one should write only out of a commitment to the present, in order to change the world. Now, after 10 years or more, the man of letters, restored to his loftiest dignity, can happily write out of pure love of writing. And so I now feel free to tell, for sheer narrative pleasure, the story of Adso of Melk. And I am comforted and consoled in finding it immeasurably remote in time, now that the waking of reason has dispelled all the monsters that its sleep had generated, gloriously lacking in any relevance for our day, atemporally alien to our hopes and our certainties. For it is a tale of books, not of everyday worries, and reading it can lead us to recite, with our Kempis, the great imitator, "In omnibus requiem quaesivi, et nusquam inveni nisi in angulo cum libro." January 5th, 1980. Note: Adso's manuscript is divided into 7 days, and each day into periods corresponding to the liturgical hours. The subtitles in the third person were probably added by Vallée. But since they are helpful in orienting the reader, and since this usage is also not unknown to much of the vernacular literature of the period, I did not feel it necessary to eliminate them. Adso's references to the canonical hours caused me some puzzlement, because their meaning varied according to the place and the season. Moreover, it is entirely probable that in the 14th century the instructions given by St. Benedict in the Rule were not observed with absolute precision. Nevertheless, as a guide to the reader, the following schedule is, I believe, credible. It is partly deduced from the text and partly based on a comparison of the original Rule with the description of monastic life given by Edouard Schneider in Les Heures Benedictines, Paris, Grasse, 1925. Matins, which Adso sometimes refers to by the older expression vigilie, between 2:30 and 3 in the morning. Lords, which in the most ancient tradition were called matutini or matins, between 5 and 6 in the morning, in order to end at dawn. Prime, around 7:30, shortly before daybreak. Terse, around 9 o'clock. Sext noon, in a monastery where the monks did not work in the fields, it was also the hour of the midday meal in winter. Nones, between 2 and 3 in the afternoon. Vespers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.